guys. So in my last video, I showed you how I painted dots for eyes, watercolor commission. So today I'm going to show you how I paint a detailed chibi, watercolor commission. And one of the biggest things that differs between the two commissions is the amount of detail in the character that I put in. Her face is more rendered, her clothes have more detail. On this one, she is a little bit bigger. This is 7x9, I want to say, watercolor paper, and it is nicer watercolor paper. You can request the upgrade. Now, the detailed chibi watercolors start at, I want to say, $25. They're a little bit more expensive than the dots for eyes, but they include a lot more detail. So I'm going to take you guys through my painting process for this. So the first thing I'm going to do is the same as what I did for the dots for eyes. In fact, this whole process is very similar. There's graphite on the back of this. It's been taped to my watercolor paper. I'm going to do a graphite transfer now of my sketch onto this watercolor paper. And this is Arch's rough press watercolor paper, which I like painting on, but it takes more pressure sometimes to transfer your image, and I'm definitely going to have to go over the image again. It's definitely harder to do the transfers on this paper because the texture of the paper itself makes it very easy for your pencil to slip and kind of go off with a mind of its own. Usually when I work on Arch's rough press, I will do pencils directly on it and then ink it, just because this is so difficult. Well, it's really rough on my wrist is the truth, because I have to bear down hard and then I'm going to have to draw over it again if the transfer isn't good enough. All right, so the transfer itself isn't that bad. The daisy is definitely cloudy. I'm gonna have to clean that up. So I'm gonna sort of selectively tighten up certain areas and also clean them up a bit with, there it is. And like with the dots for eyes, I can clean it up afterwards by sort of tightening it up in pencil. And I actually think, rather than messing around with the little ones, I'm going to switch over to my regular palette, which I'll do sometimes if I know there are colors in the commission that I wouldn't be able to easily mix from that little palette. It can be a bit restricting. So for the detailed chibi commission, I'm going to go ahead and mix up a color for the background. And I was thinking sort of like a cerulean blue might be nice. And I'm going to go ahead and grab a wash brush. This is just a Cotman mop. And I've got two clean cups of water. And you really want to start with clean water when you're starting a commission or any watercolor piece. Because if you're starting with dirty water, it's going to make the whole piece look muddy and just not as crisp and vibrant as you could get if you were starting with clean water. So now I'm going to go ahead and lay down that wash. And I'm kind of avoiding her face. Just because sometimes with a wash like a blue or a purple or a green, it can kind of negatively affect the skin color. And it'll never really look as like clean as it ought to. It can make it look a little bit muddy. I'm also using the blue wash selectively to push certain elements into the background or to knock them into shadow. And one of the nice things about working with arches is that since it's a nicer quality watercolor paper, I can do tricks with it that I wouldn't otherwise be able to do with cheaper cellulose-based papers. So I can do a gradiated wash. By applying a darker color at the top and then tilting the page so it will run. And that's only going to go where you've applied water. So if you need to touch it up, that's something to think about. And if you don't want it at the bottom, you can just sort of gently skim it with your paintbrush. And this is perfect for skies, since they are darker the further up. So I'm going to let that dry a little bit, and then I may or may not add another layer of blue depending on how it looks when it's dry. So my paper is still pretty wet, but some of the water, most of the water has kind of soaked in. So I'm going to go ahead and do another wash. Mostly because the sky isn't quite as dark as I wanted. And I'm holding it at an angle to encourage it to flow downwards. And even on a pre-stretched watercolor paper like this, if you add too much water, or you hit the saturation point, it'll start to buckle. And that's just a good opportunity to sort of let the paper rest. So I'm going to dab up a little bit of this excess blue. And it won't even be noticeable when I start painting because her hair is brown. If you were doing a blonde person or someone with like light colored hair, you would want to make sure that the blue didn't permeate the area too much because it would be very difficult to cover that up. All right, so this is mostly dry. It's still cool to the touch, which means the paper fibers themselves are wet, but I can start mixing up my skin tone. And I already put some water in that little well right there. And I'm taking some yellow ochre, which has been activated by dropping a couple of drops of water into it in advance, and some scarlet. And just sort of eyeballing it. I paint light skin tones so often that I can eyeball them pretty decently. And I said in my last video that I'm using Princeton Neptune brushes. I don't actually recommend these. These are what I use for con watercolors because they were affordable and they're synthetics, so you can kind of abuse them and they won't get completely wrecked. But they don't hold a point either, so you're really just pushing paint around rather than actually painting. And I'm going to go ahead and fill in all of the areas of skin with an initial like color fill. Okay, so that first layer of skin dried, and as a warning, it's raining outside, and on evenings that are high humidity or are actually raining, you're going to find your dry time is a little bit to a lot of it longer, and you may also notice that you're having problems with blooms and bleeds that you wouldn't normally have. That's one of the reasons I stopped offering watercolor commissions done at con. Because I just can't control the weather, and exterior conditions do affect watercolor so much, much more than people, sometimes even myself, think about when I'm working. So when I'm doing shading on the face, I like to, for the second layer of color or the first layer of shading, I kind of like to do what seems like a mask around the eyes. Just to sort of set them backwards in the forehead. And this is particularly true when I'm doing like these sort of cutesy chibi illustrations. I know every face varies, but for this sort of very stylized art, it just tends to work out well in general. And I do this when I do digital commissions as well. So this is actually something I started doing in digital commissions, and I like the effect, so I carried it over. I know it's difficult to see. I'm trying to compromise between you guys being able to see what colors I'm using when I mix and how I handle the paints on the paper. So this is going to take a little while to dry. And I'm going to go ahead and mix the next color. What I really need is like a flexible gooseneck instead of the sort of clamp I have. That way I could just like guide the camera over to what I'm doing. Of course, then you guys might end up with like motion sickness, so maybe that's not a great idea. So I am going to start mixing the color for her hair while I wait for her skin to dry. And that means I do a couple of drops of water onto the pans I'm going to use. And I also should start thinking about what colors I'm going to paint her her shirt and her shorts. Now I want the daisy in the background to have yellow petals and maybe like a yellow-green center. So I'm gonna activate those as well as a green. Try to carefully dab up some extra water that I got flung on. So usually when I do something with a lot of blue, if I'm doing it for a commission and the commissioner hasn't specified what they'd like, I like to go for an orange because it's like a nice pop of color. I do tend to default to that. So I'm going to go with a cute yellow orange that I kind of favor. And I think I want her shorts to be like a golden ochre color. I think, well, maybe that wouldn't work so well. If it was a straight orange, it would look good. I mean, straight yellow, it would look good. But it's a yellow orange. And the ochre might be just not a good fit. And I don't really want to do purple. I guess I will stick with ochre. And if you are having trouble sometimes making a swatch like this, because then you can look, this is the orange we're going to end up with, and these are the ochres I'm thinking about. So having these to look at can help you decide on your color palette while you work. You can also make swatches. That's perfectly acceptable. I just don't want to mix a bunch of color to try and determine where I'm going. And I'm going to go ahead and sort of smooth out some of the color application on the face. Not a whole lot. I just figured since it's so damp outside and my paper is staying very moist, I should take advantage of that. So I'm also going to start mixing up the color that I'm going to use for her blush. And I like using Alsarian Crimson with a little bit of orange. And it takes only a very little bit because these colors pack quite a punch and they tend to be more opaque than translucent. So I make sure on skin I water them down enough because they can get kind of overwhelming. I'm gonna get started on that daisy. And see, the problem with the blue, even though the blue is a very pure blue, it is also very granulating. That means all those like speckles you see in the blue, that's different parts of the pigment settle into the texture of the page. And usually I want that, but on the flower, it makes it look kind of dirty. And that's just the combination of that blue with that yellow, because this is a warmer blue. And if you want to use it, and I mean, this is a warmer yellow, so it is a best case scenario. But it will, there is a potential for it to look a little bit muddy. Or like I wasn't really certain what colors I wanted to use. So I need to let all this, oh wait, there's one more thing I think I can, no, I need to let this dry before I do that. All right, so I'll see you guys in a minute. Okay, so things are a little more dry and I can progress a little further. This is sort of a yellow green that I'm doing in the center, a green gold, although it is a little more dirty looking than I planned on. And her face, the paint on her face, that's the phrase I was looking for. That's dry, so I can go ahead and mix up her hair color. And I do need to let the flower dry before I can go into that. But I'm going to go ahead and do the shadow on her eye. And I'm using, it's a convenience color. It's Payne's Gray. It's a pre-mixed gray. I could mix gray a variety of ways, but I use a lot of it. So I like having it handy. And I'm going to go ahead and do the shading on her eyes. And then I'm going to blend that out. And then use a clean paper towel. I like to use Viva. Sort of dot out the highlights of her eyes so that they aren't as shaded as the rest of the eye. And I guess I could go ahead and paint her shirt in. So my yellow orange is pretty much ready to go. All right, so that's the first layer on her shirt. And one of the reasons I like this color, this is Indian yellow from Soho, which is a Jerry's Artarama brand. And it's a very economical brand. It's like $3.99 a tube. You can often find them on sale. It is not archival, not necessarily light fast. So when I'm doing commissions for other people, I avoid this color. But when I'm doing Kara pages or I'm doing my own stuff, and it doesn't really matter because it's going to be sitting in a box or it's going to be scanned and then reproduced, I go ahead and use the color if I want to because I happen to like that color. I think it's a very bright, sunny, cheerful color. I just wanted you guys to be aware of its properties before you take my recommendation in case archival or light fast are important for you. So I need to let these things dry before I can move on. All right, so everything is dry to the touch, albeit a little bit cool, which, like we said, indicates that the paper is still damp, but you're not going to get, you shouldn't get, bleeding or pooling. And we're going to start with the blush. And I like to apply it pretty liberally on the cheeks, especially in the initial layers and across the bridge of the nose. And it gives characters kind of a sun-kissed look. Also like to do it at the tops of the ears. Definitely on the knees, on the knuckles, and the inside of the elbow. And of course, on the lips. And also on eyelids. And that's just my personal preference for coloring blush. There are lots of ways you can do it. And since it's kind of light, I'm going to mix it a little bit darker for the next layer. So a little bit more of the Alizarin Crimson. And then a little bit more of that orange. I'm going to let it dry. And I think I'm going to start her shorts. And we talked about her shorts being sort of like a gold yellow ochre color. And yellow ochre is often kind of translucent, or I'm sorry, kind of opaque, really. So, if you want it to be translucent, if you want to be able to build up intensity of color, you do need to mix it with water first. And that flower in her hair is kind of bugging me, just because it is still really muddy. And you can salvage that to a certain extent with color pencils and with gouache, but I want to have that as minimal as possible. So a blush on her cheeks. Her lips have dried, so I'm gonna darken it a little bit while it's still wet, and that way it'll diffuse above her eyes. And I need to let that dry, and then I can continue to assess the situation. All right, so everything but her cheeks and her lips are fairly dry. So I can move back on to those shorts for another layer of color. Working on building up shadows, pushing background objects or the background part of the so the shorts that are on the leg that would be furthest from the viewer, I'm trying to make those recede into the background. And I'm going to soften that edge and soften that edge a little bit. And I'm gonna also go back into the cheeks.
So what's frustrating about this sort of weather where it's raining outside is parts are staying damp. Like, so this cheek was still damp, this cheek was not. So I'm not getting consistent applications of color. And there are ways you can kind of fudge that a little bit. But it's still annoying. It's an annoying thing to have to take into consideration. And I'm bringing it up so that you guys can make accommodations for it if you need to. Now I'm gonna color in the stem on that daisy. Starting with that green gold. And I really like this color. It just didn't work very well in that flower. That flower's kind of a mess. I'm gonna try and salvage it as much as possible with some Copic opaque white, maybe even bring out some pencil colors. And with the detail Chibi, I don't do as much color detail as I would with my more detailed, serious commissions. So there's sort of a step in between my dots for eyes, which I showed you last video, and like the sort of stuff I would do for 7-inch Kara or for more expensive commissions. There's something really cozy feeling, as much as I'm complaining about the weather. There's something really cozy about it being night and there's thunder outside, and you're just kind of amusing yourself by painting. So, I don't know, just makes you grateful that you're inside and you're safe and you're warm. So, I'm doing the third layer of skin, and I'm darkening up the area that would be covered by her bangs because that would cast a natural shadow. I'm also sort of reinforcing the contours of her face that might have gotten a little bit lost. Coloring underneath her lip and the dimple as well. For her ear, I'm going to fill in everything underneath this curl, and I could definitely go a little bit darker with the skin tone because it doesn't have as much contrast as I would like. And I think after this layer, I'm going to mix it darker. So if you're noticing, if you're sort of an illustrator with a cartoony style, and you're noticing that your stuff looks muddy, it may be because you're just not putting in enough contrast. So everything is the same value and it looks overworked. That is a problem I've noticed that I have. So it's something I'm working on. Mix that a little bit darker. But it's also the sort of thing you're going to get a feel for as you learn and grow as an artist. So I wouldn't stress out about it too much. I would just focus on learning from past mistakes. Like that green there might have been a mistake. And I'm trying to reinforce that color on the stem. So it doesn't look like it just came out of nowhere. I also have to be careful because Kara's skin is white, I mean wet. So I want to be delicate in where I put that green because it will bleed into the wet if I'm not careful. So again, gotta let that dry. Right, so my skin appears to be dry. And while I could do another layer of that, I think it's time to start knocking in her hair and her eyes to check for contrast, because I don't want them to be so similar that one starts getting lost. And as you can see, that warm brown. I mean, this is just the first layer, but it already starts to cover up the blue, which is why I was really not worried about the blue in the hair. I should have been more worried about the flower, and I did try to absorb a lot of the blue from the sky with like a paper towel, which is a pretty good technique. But I went over it so many times that, of course, some got in. And I usually let my paintbrush or my marker, depending on which I'm using, do a lot of the work when I'm knocking in highlights. Which is why if you have a good paintbrush or one that holds a point well, it's a lot easier. This one's being okay for right now. And see, just by knocking in this first layer of hair, there'll probably be at least two more. I can see that I want to do more contrast on the skin. I mean, I figured I was going to anyway, but now I know for sure. Whereas before I did the hair, I wasn't really sure how much contrast I was going to need. And I'm also going to dot in freckles. And with freckles, you kind of want them to, you don't want them to be uniform, and you want them to be kind of like oblong in shape, not perfectly round. The more irregular they are, the more realistic they're going to look. And these should hopefully dry pretty light. Because I also like to build up layers of freckles. So that's done. I can move on to probably one last layer in the shorts. And I mixed in some Van Dyke brown into the umbers I was using. And I maybe should have mixed a little more. I was worried it would look too different. Here we go. And start with her boots. So since everything is dry, except for a little bitty bit on her shoes, I'm adding what I hope is the last layer of shading on her skin. I may have to do another layer on this arm that's behind her or under her neck or on the far leg. But I don't want to do too much more on her face. And I like to do shading on the eyes in a variety of ways. But for a cute style like this, the sort of crescent moon shading underneath the highlights of her eyes really works well. All right, so it looks like her skin is pretty much dry. So I'm going to go a little bit darker with the orange on her shirt. Mix that in. And then also go in a little darker on the buckle of her shoe. And I think do another layer on her hair before I mix it any darker. Now, I imagine the light source is coming from her left or right. So I'm darkening, and that's kind of like a cheaty way I have when I'm doing these sort of commissions that need to be knocked out fairly fast and with fairly reasonable consistency is that I will, the light source is coming from the direction that's closest to the viewer. I mean, if the commissioner specifies something different, then of course I'll accommodate that. But for when they don't specify or if it doesn't matter, I will usually do it on the side that is closest to the viewer, partially because it helps the other end, the other side sort of recess into the background. It makes it look a little bit more three-dimensional. And I'm still trying to let the brush do most of the work for the hair. And my light's kind of blowing out what I'm doing, making it a little harder to see than I would like. And I need to be delicate around the buckle because it's still wet. All right, so it's time to let that hair dry. Okay, so everything is dry for the most part. And I'm gonna go ahead and knock this leg and the arm a little further back in space. Hopefully, that's the plan. Add a little more shading to that ear and that nose. Ow! Shoot. I'm sorry. My cat insists on being on my lap, which makes it very hard to paint. And he likes to dig those claws right into the softest part of my leg meat for security, humbo. Wow, I don't really appreciate it, and I might just have to boot him. Give that old gray cat the boot. All right, so I need to let all of that dry before I can go back into the hair and start darkening it up. All right, so it seems like since it stopped raining outside, everything is drying a little bit quicker, which is nice. It's good for me. And I mixed up a dark brown, pretty much just Van Dyke brown with water, but I wanted to be able to consistently get coverage. And I might have to mix it a little darker. And remember that this is going to dry a lot lighter than it goes down. So I'm probably going to be mixing it darker and applying another layer because I don't think it's dark enough. Not as dark as I would like it. I'm going to go ahead and do another layer on her eyes as well and start mixing the dark brown darker. All right, so her hair is mostly dry. And I think first, though, I'm going to go ahead and paint in her eyelashes. So with this sort of style, I kind of have open eyelashes, and I like to, on larger pieces like this, I like to paint them in with the lighter color of hair first, and then kind of go over them with the darker color, just to sort of make them look fuller and not, like, less unfinished. And I'm doing another layer of freckles, and I'm doing them a little bit smaller and a little more intense. And let's see if I can zoom in. It makes it look a lot more like actual freckles. Also, it seems like everything is currently dry. So it's time to go back into that hair with that darker color I mixed. Hopefully it'll be dark enough. If not, I'm just going to have to work straight from the pan. It's a little bit better. See, the problem was not that it's a different color, but that it was not building up contrast enough, so it made it hard to read the shapes. And I might even have to go over it again. And it looks good when wet, but colors do dry lighter, so it's important to give it time to dry before you make a final decision, because you may need to darken it up.
Okay, so this shade of brown is almost dark enough. I'm going to go directly into the Van Dyke brown over here
and darken it up just a little bit more, because I want to get some definition. I really need to switch out my con commission brushes, because there are better inexpensive brushes on the market that would be able to do this a little bit better. And I can knock it out a little quicker then.
See, that's the thing about inexpensive materials is, yes, you can make them work for you, but often what you save on money, you're gonna pay back in time.
And if you're a student and you have time to kill, your classes aren't particularly demanding, or you're just flat out broke and you can't afford better, it'll work. And honestly, by the time you're ready for the nicer materials, it will seem like such a huge upgrade, because they won't fight you as hard.
So I'm not super happy about the highlights right now, but there's a way that I can kind of fix that, and I'll do so in a minute. This layer of paint has to dry. All right, so gotta let that dry. Well, while I do that, I can
go back into that blush color I mixed
and better delineate a couple things. All right, dry time. Okay, so her hair is still a little wet, but I wanted to darken up the eyelashes a bit, and I'll probably have to go over them again.
Helps if you make weird noises. Not really, but makes it a little more entertaining. Color in her eyes a little bit more.
And now I want to use some of the skin tone I mixed
to start delineating areas of her skin a little bit better. And I may have to wait until it's fully dry to do the face. But I can definitely do under the chin. And around the neck. And do the nose and do the dimple. For me, watercolors are all about doing progressively smaller areas. So you start big and you work your way inward or smaller, adding more detail and more shadow as you go along. Giving things time to dry and then going back to them and continuing to work on them.
All right, so off camera, I went ahead and I mixed a couple of colors darker. The skin tone for one, and the color I'm using for her pants as the other. And I'm darkening the color for the shirt just a bit. And I'm going to use that as an outliner.
I might even have to go a little bit darker with this one, but I didn't want to start off so dark because then I wouldn't have anywhere to go, if that makes sense. It would be too much of a discrepancy. I can always go back and mix a little darker, mix some red in there maybe, especially on the areas where it's just not showing up at all. And having multiple colors utilized in your outline also makes it look less like an outline and more like a three-dimensional shape. That's a little bit of red in there, possibly too much.
And if you get it too dark, if you catch it while it's still wet, you can also blend it out a little bit, sort of soften that color.
And then for her eyelashes. And this is the thing, if you haven't eaten properly all day, if you've been at a con all day, the fine details are where you're going to get really tripped up because your hand may start shaking and you need that fine motor, those fine motor skills to be working in your favor. And those, for me, those are some of the first to go. My hands start shaking really bad, and that's when I know I have to call it an evening. Whether or not I'm finished, I'd rather have to pay to mail something or even refund their money than give them something that I couldn't do a good job on because I was so exhausted. But I was stubborn and persisted because, I don't know, that just seems so disappointing. Like, you paid good money in good faith. And the artist opted to pull all night, an all-nighter, and finish the piece, but it doesn't necessarily look like the quality you'd been pitched. And by doing these watercolors as mail-ins only, I now can exceed the quality pitch, so I think people are generally always over-delivered, right? They have something more than what I told them they would get. So I need to let this dry, and then I can do the skin tone. So now is the time I'm going to try and salvage that daisy. And I've got some Copic opaque white here. You can also use white gouache. Both are water-based opaque white solutions. And I mix it up with a little bit of water to make it workable. And hopefully it'll stay wet long enough that I can blend those first couple layers. And the reason I'm doing that is just because I'm going to do a couple of layers of the opaque white. And I want there to be a more subtle transition between the opaque white and the yellow of the flowers. So I am applying some and then blending it in towards the middle of the petal. And then I'll probably go over it maybe one or two times. It really depends on how it looks when it's dry. Just realized I could probably even build it up more than I did. And then maybe even go back over it with yellow if I'm careful. All right, so I'm gonna let that dry. Okay, so the opaque white definitely, well, I mean, I think it looks better than it did. So I'm going to try and go over it with some yellow, and I might live to regret it. And see, that yellow is much more vibrant now. That said, though, after putting down opaque white, I wouldn't expect, even if I'm using the same color, I wouldn't expect it to be exactly the same as it looked the first time I put it on the paper. So basically, I wouldn't try to do color matching because I think that's kind of probably a lost cause at this point. It is nice, though, to know that you're able to salvage something. And then add white highlights as needed. Or, you know, as your tastes dictate. If you have a very anime sort of style, then you're going to want lots of white highlights. You're going to want lots of bouncing, reflecting light. If you have a more realistic style, you're probably going to want very selective white highlights. It's really all about what you want in your piece. Blend out that white highlight a bit. This one as well. Just to sort of lower the intensity. With good gouaches and with opaque white, you can, as long as it's still moderately wet, you can still kind of brush out some of the opaque white to soften the highlight, or to blend it out a little bit.
course, gotta let that dry. All right, so I keep saying this. I keep saying we're just about done. We're just about done. But I think for reals, though, this is it. I think I am pretty much finished. Because all I really wanted to do was add some highlights on the flower. And I think that is about it. So, this would be an example of one of my detailed Chibi commissions. They are, the base price is plus five to whatever size Dots Rise watercolor commission you might be going for. So they start at 25. They have the large anime style eyes, the cute chibi style proportions, and they're in watercolor. You guys see me do it. That is one of my take-home commission options. It's also an option that you could purchase online if we never meet at conventions. It's perfect for your adorable children. It's perfect to commemorate yourself and a friend, a pet you love, nieces and nephews, your favorite character. It's a versatile style, and I get a lot of requests for these at shows. I love doing them. I love painting, and I love making art for people, and I like getting paid to make art for people, so it's like perfect combination of great things. If you have any questions or if there's anything I can do to help you out, let me know. So long as it doesn't severely curtail my own ability to make a living, I would be more than happy to help you get started or get going. I'm Becca Hilburn. This is Natto Soup Studios YouTube channel. If you enjoyed this video, please remember to like. Please consider subscribing to my channel for more tutorials like this. Please check out the blog, nattosoup.blogspot.com, where I have over 7 years worth of tutorials, reviews, and demonstrations that you can check out. If you really, really, really like content like this, and you really, really want to help support content like this, and you want more of it, you could check out my Patreon, patreon.com/nattosoup. It's a crowdfunding site for creators who do long form projects. So they're consistently putting work out, which is me. Your financial support, your emotional support is what keeps me able to do this. I am a stay-at-home freelance artist, so I do depend on work coming in. And these sort of videos, those sort of blog posts do take a lot of time to do, to edit, to promote. So it is work. I hope you guys have a great day. Hopefully I'll see you at a con sometime. But if not, I'm Becca Hilburn, and I'll see you guys later. Bye!